Introducing the Jackson 5. EastEnders on BBC One.
The targets change. The terror does not. The bloody history of 40 years of terrorism. Age of Terror, Tuesday at 9 on BBC Two.
Newsnight now on BBC Two Wales with Jeremy Paxman.
They may cut interest rates again tomorrow, but is it time the government had some other bright idea to save the economy? Tomorrow morning, the Bank of England will decide what should happen to British interest rates. The betting is they'll cut them again. But with doom and gloom all round, is this one mechanism anything like adequate to deal with the trouble that seems to be looming? Willing to greet it in Britain but not to see it lit in Beijing, the Prime Minister's not going to the Olympic opening ceremony. A flash protest in Zimbabwe as the state grinds its way through the election results. And is anxiety over the fate of the Jodrell Bank Observatory symbolic of wholesale betrayal of pure science in Britain?
Physics and astronomy in the UK faces a funding crisis, yet the government keeps telling us science fuels all our futures. So should heads roll?
Good evening. Woe, woe, thrice woe. The International Monetary Fund has slashed its forecast for the rate at which the British economy will grow this year. The Bank of England has found that borrowing money on a mortgage is more expensive than it's been for 7 years. The number of mortgages taken out has fallen for the fourth month running. The pound will buy you fewer euros than ever before. Question: what should the Monetary Policy Committee of the Bank of England decide tomorrow to do with our interest rates? And has the Bank of England been active enough in supporting the markets? In a moment, we'll be hearing from our own Monetary Policy Committee. First tonight, Gillian Lacey-Solimar reports.
It's very rare for economists to agree on anything at all. But given the barrage of bad news there's been, the city has come to a broad consensus that base rates have to fall. The problem is that the transmission mechanism whereby the base rates feed through to the broader economy has, in these rather strange times, broken down.
Well, traditionally, the transmission mechanism functions by the Bank of England lending to commercial banks at the base rate, or what's called the bank rate. That becomes the benchmark at which banks lend to each other and borrow from each other. But since the credit crisis broke out last August, banks have been much more cautious about lending to each other. And when they do, they lend at much higher rates. Now that's filtered through to households and industry, so that when they borrow from the banks themselves, that borrowing takes place at much higher rates than it would have done otherwise.
LIBOR, or the London Interbank Rate, is the name of this rate at which banks lend to one another. Normally it stands at up to a quarter of 1% above the base rate. But these are not normal times. Here's the base rate since the start of the credit crunch, moving downwards from 5.75%. And here's LIBOR rising to almost 7%, the differential reaching well over 1% above base in recent months. A sign of exactly how reluctant the banks are to lend to each other. With this anomalous situation, the Council of Mortgage Lenders admit that if there were a rate change, it's not particularly likely that financial institutions would pass it on to their customers.
There's a move away from the situation we used to have of interest rates being passed on immediately to both borrowers and savers. There's strong competition for savings funds, which implies you should keep the rates up as high as you can. At the same time, the costs of funds have gone up because many loans are not linked to the base rate, and that means that lenders haven't been passing on all the changes that we've had, and I wouldn't expect there'd be a routine passing on by all the lenders this week.
And around half of mortgage customers wouldn't get a direct benefit of base rate changes anyway, as they're on fixed rate mortgages. The UK and US authorities have handled the credit crunch very differently. In the US, the authorities have reacted more decisively and more dramatically. Interest rates in the UK were 5.75% last autumn and are now 5.25%, two cuts in total. That's versus the United States, where rates were 5.25% last autumn and are now only 2.25%, six cuts in all. In the States, there's also been massive injections of liquidity, and many feel that our own central bank should be more active to keep the economy from severe problems.
They have auctions each month. They've announced an increase in the amount available in the auction in April, but one auction and a month-by-month approach just simply isn't enough of a commitment for lenders to plan ahead in the long term in terms of their funding strategies for the rest of this year. They need to have more auctions, higher amounts, a wider approach to the assets they're prepared to swap to give funds to the banks, and then the banks will be able to use those funds back into the mortgage market and deal with the problem of the demand being out there not being met by supply.
These steps are very, very technical, and they take a lot of thinking and a lot of drafting. But we suspect that the Bank of England may be drawing up such measures to be introduced perhaps over the coming weeks.
So, against this background of cries for action, how do the economic foundations look? It's not a constructive picture overall, but nor is it a scenario of unremitting gloom. Unemployment remains relatively low and has been falling for 17 months. And the retail volumes took everyone by surprise when they rose in February by 1%. Then, today's manufacturing figures were marginally up on the previous 3 months. Growth prospects, though, do look relatively weak. The IMF today reduced their forecast of growth to 1.6%, which compares poorly to the midpoint of the Treasury's forecast of 2%. Slower growth is in part due to the housing market.
A year ago, the bank and building societies were falling over themselves to lend us credit. Now the situation couldn't be more different. We're at a 12-year low in terms of mortgage approvals. Also, we heard from the Halifax that house prices dropped 2.5% in 1 month alone, and in real terms are also falling year on year. And whereas a year ago there were 27 companies offering us 100% mortgages, now there are none. For example, the Cheltenham and Gloucester disappeared from the 100% mortgage market in March. Last week, Nationwide did exactly the same. And Abbey did its disappearing trick yesterday, becoming the last player to exit the 100% mortgage market.
All this suggests that rates should fall, but it's not that simple. There's significant inflation in the system.
We've got inflation at 2.5% at the moment and likely to rise above 3% over the summer. There are a number of inflation pressures in the system, particularly coming from food, energy and the fall in the pound over the past few months. The risk is perhaps that we get wages responding to higher headline inflation and that we see a worse inflation picture in the medium term. And that's a big worry for the Bank of England.
As the MPC's remit is to keep inflation in balance within the 2% target, these factors can't be ignored. But then, nor can the need to reinforce the economy in this daunting period.
So just before we speak to our own Monetary Policy Committee, Paul Mason is here to talk a little more about that IMF report. What is the big issue on the minds of finance ministers at that meeting?
Top of the agenda is nothing less than the re-regulation of the global banking system, because the current regulatory system and the rules and controls just haven't stopped the crisis. The IMF is saying to governments, it's pleading with them not to rush into legislation about this, but there is quite a detailed plan and set of ideas for making the existing rules and the existing regulators work better. Number one, says the fund, if a bank goes bust, as with Bear Stearns, bail it out, pile in there. You may be operating at the very limit of your legal power, but you have to do it. Don't wait for politics. The other thing is the so-called Basel II rules, the new rules for banking. It's a new international agreement designed in a previous era. This has got to be really rigorously applied. Otherwise, the whole thing could spiral out of control again. Another big thing which will affect everybody, as we saw there in Gillian's report, is that they want the mortgage lending system to be much more tightly controlled internationally. Now, this bunch of politicians is philosophically inclined to deregulation. That's probably all they've known for the last 10, 15 years. To have to re-regulate, it's quite difficult. I know the British government is worried that some of them will turn up and say, yes, fine, and do nothing.
How much more of the credit crunch is there to play out?
Well, of the $1 trillion we heard today that's due to go up in smoke, half of it will be lost by banks, the other half by hedge funds, pension funds and the like. But the bigger issue is what they call systemic risk. That is the risk that a big bank fails and takes the world economy with it. Let me show you a graph from today's report. It's a bit scary. It's buried in the deep in the report where people of a nervous disposition can't see it. Here is the risk of a big bank going bust. Before, it was negligible. Now, it's above 5%. Now, 5% doesn't sound much, but in racing terms, it's 20 to 1. And says the fund, if that happens, if a big bank goes, it will take 5 or 6 out of the top 15 banks with it. That's the precipice we're looking at.
OK, you've got very little time to say this. Monetary Policy Committee tomorrow, our own shadow Monetary Policy Committee about to discuss it. What does it mean for them?
I think they have to bear in mind the limitations of monetary policy when we're faced with a crisis of this nature. That old quote from J.M. Keynes will be rolled out again and again in the coming months. Let me be one of the first to say it. Faced with this, you know, monetary policy is like pushing a piece of string.
Paul, thank you. Well, just before we hear from our own esteemed Monetary Policy Committee, here's a brief reminder of who they are. Joining us from Washington is Dr. Erwin Stelzer, a passionate advocate of the free market. His weekly column in the Sunday Times is informed by access to the highest levels of government. Ruth Lee's extensive CV includes stints at the Treasury. She's currently governor of the London School of Economics. As former director of the Institute for Public Policy Research, Jerry Holtham helped shape the thinking of New Labour. And finally, the former Tory Chancellor Kenneth Clarke won't be able to join his colleagues on the Newsnight Monetary Policy Committee in the studio, but we will be hearing his views on what the real-life MPC should do later. OK, let's go straight away to Washington and hear from Erwin Stelzer. First of all, Erwin Stelzer, do you think that interest rates are at all an adequate mechanism for dealing with the problem we face?
No, they're part of what ought to be done, and only a part, but they're not an insignificant part. The fact that when the monetary authorities cut interest rates, all other rates don't go down simply shows the banks are trying to build their capital, build their profits, and are very, very nervous about lending. So it's part of what you should do, but it's only a part. And I think that's going to be the real problem for the Bank of England, whether they grasp the notion that much more has to be done than simply play around with interest rates.
Do you guys agree with Erwin Stelzer?
Yes, I basically do, and I think actually the Bank of England has grasped that by now. Of course, the Fed has been on to this for quite some time. But I suspect, following on from what Coogan was saying in your film, that not just will they cut interest rates tomorrow, but they will be looking to put more liquidity into the money markets. And I suspect, too, they will also try and ease the criteria for letting longer-term funding go into the markets, which is, again, something that was mentioned on your film. I think all those things actually now need to be done, and I think the bank will do them.
What, Jerry Holtham, do you think that Alistair Darling could do in addition to what the Monetary Policy Committee might do?
I think it's difficult for him to do anything very much until he sees real economy consequences of the credit crunch. At the moment, we're seeing a clear softening in the housing market. A lot of other data, people mentioned employment, is so far holding up. My own view is that's just a question of lags. In time, it's all going to look very soft, and I think at that point, he'll have the political capital, if you like, to consider other action. Right now, it's difficult.
Playing the game of being you guys being the Monetary Policy Committee, does it make sense to limit its remit to inflation and what the consequences of interest rates will be for inflation?
Absolutely not. All central banks are living in the past. They're living in the era 1950 to 1980, which is the only time in world history when a wage-price spiral has been the main issue. We've had about 5 global recessions since 1980. Not one of them has been caused by a wage-price spiral. They've all been caused by asset market disturbances and busts. So for a central bank to focus on the retail price index and wage inflation and ignore the asset markets is asinine. So they've got to look at house prices, they've got to look at the stock market and credit growth in general.
I think that's actually very fair, and I would like to see the Bank of England's remit, which is just about consumer prices at the moment, actually amended to take account of asset prices.
But you're sitting, supposing you are sitting there on the Monetary Policy Committee, Can you actually do that? Well, you've got one overriding priority.
You have to go for a walk to the Treasury and actually say to the Chancellor of the Exchequer, it's time you actually looked at the remit, and I think they'll have to do this. But could I just comment on something that Jerry's just said about the wage price spiral? Okay, we may not have seen anything like a wage price spiral since perhaps the 1980s, but the truth is you can't totally discount and ignore it. But I just happen to think that this time, even if consumer price inflation goes up to 3%, which I think we now expect it to do, I don't actually think that this time it will knock on into higher pay settlements or higher earnings, because there's too much uncertainty within the economy. So I think the bank should actually just relax about the inflationary pressures that are in the economy.
Sitting there on the committee, Owen Stelzer, you'd be feeling frustrated, wouldn't you?
Well, I would feel humble. This is a tough
Surely
business.
Not. It's
uncharacteristically humble, I should add. This is a tough business, and I think there's one thing Alistair Darling can do, that when he gets a letter from the governor of the Bank of England explaining why interest rates are above 2%, which is, I think, mandated, he can say, yes, we understand, and forget about it. The notion of targeting asset prices, house prices, stock prices, while I think they should not be ignored, I think Alan Greenspan did have a point when he said, how do you know when there's a bubble? So I think they should look at it, they should watch it, but again, I would be very careful about it, about saying, well, that's as high as I think prices ought to go, we're now going to tighten up. I do agree that inflation is right now the lesser concern. If they overshoot a little bit on cutting interest rates and inflation does take off a bit, which I'm not sure it will, they can reverse gears pretty quickly. But if they guess wrong and keep interest rates too high and don't do the other things that have been suggested, they're going to find themselves in a very, very difficult situation.
Paul Mason raised a very interesting point, didn't he? Is this generation of politicians who've really only been concerned with travelling in one direction, are they up to the dealing with the completely changed circumstances that they now may find themselves facing? What do you think about that, Jerry Hall?
I think it's very difficult for them. I mean, as the nationwide episode proved, I mean, the deep reluctance of the government to grasp that nettle was very clear, and they were very much afraid that they'd be tarred with some sort of old nationalisation brush, and that clearly interfered
in
with
Northern
their perception.
Rock matter.
What did I say?
You said nationwide.
I do beg your
pardon. I was baffled. I thought I completely missed a crisis here. It's a Northern Rock problem, you mean?
Far be it from
nationwide
me to...
Nationwide is safe as houses.
Safe as houses, absolutely. No risk at all. But indeed, Northern Rock. I mean, that. I think the hesitation over that episode showed clearly that their mindset isn't right for thinking about re-regulation or anything of that sort.
Do you repose any more confidence in them, Ruth Lee?
Well, I think not really, and I would try and slightly change the issue. I think it's all about they're going to face a real slowdown in the economy. I don't think there's any doubt about that. I think the IMF talking about 1.6% GDP growth rate this year and 1.6% next year, I think that looks fair enough. But clearly, we have been told for the last 10 years by Gordon Brown and Alistair Darling that we have an amazing resilient economy, we're going to have growth and no more booms and busts, and everything in the garden's going to be lovely. And the truth is, it's not. And I really don't think psychologically they're really quite there at how they're going to deal with this.
Owen Stelzer, are you shaking your head because you agree or disagree?
Well, I'm shaking my head, first of all, because fussing over the difference in forecasts in a few tenths of a decimal place always reminds me that economists use decimal places because to prove they have a sense of humor. we don't know which of those forecasts is right. What we do know is what the risks are of guessing which one is right. And I would quite agree with Ruth that we should assume the worst and plan for the best. The second thing is, I do think you just got to grasp the fact that Britain at the moment, in policy terms, is shaving on America's beard. The Fed, which has opened its discount window to essentially bail out any investment bank in trouble, and almost all have gone to the Fed, those are big investment banks in Britain. So we are, by virtue of Fed policy, making life somewhat easier for investment banks in Britain, which I think is a plus and ought to be kept in mind every time you blame the mortgage crisis on us. I do think there are lessons to be learned in America.
We're going to leave that that thought hanging there, as indeed we'll wrestle with the metaphor of shaving on America's beard, because it's time that you really must say what you think the Monetary Policy Committee should do tomorrow. Kenneth Clark couldn't be with us, the former Chancellor, so he couldn't be here tonight in the studio, but here's what he would do.
If I were on the MPC, I'd be voting for a modest cut in interest rates. I'd be reluctantly driven to that. The main thing that the Bank of England has to worry about is inflation. There are guards against inflation. We have inflation, as everybody listening to this knows, but it isn't spreading through to wage settlements yet. The other thing you have to look down is, how serious is the slowdown in the economy going to be? I think the bigger risk is that slowdown might get too severe. But at the moment, I want to ignore the bankers. I want to not try and fix the housing market. I'd be cautious. So I would vote for a 25 basis point, 0.25% cut in rates tomorrow.
Owen Seltzer, I hope you've got a card there in Washington. Tell us what you do.
Well, should I hold up the card?
Yes, please. We can't see it if you don't. That's upside down. I take it you don't want it to go up. No, that's marvelous.
How's that? I would err on the side of stimulating the economy, because this is a if I'm wrong, it's easier to reverse this error.
Okay, Ruth.
Well, I'm going for 1.25. Sorry, 0.25.
0.25.
But if it went 0.5, I'd be perfectly content with that, especially as LIBOR rates, bank market rates, are so high at the moment.
Jerry Holton, what would you do?
I would certainly go for 0.5. What we're seeing already in the money markets is much worse than if in normal circumstances they'd raised by 0.5. So if they cut by 0.5, they will not be doing much more than restoring the status quo of about a month or two ago.
Okay, thank you all very much indeed. Now, maybe Gordon Brown was teasing all along, because it turns out he's not going to the opening ceremony of the Olympic Games anyway, so all that pressure was unnecessary. He's sending Tessa Jowell, and he'll turn up for the closing, although quite why he didn't say so before now hasn't been disclosed. The progress of the Olympic torch, meanwhile, a performance designed to show the thing off today to the people of San Francisco, descended into farce. Rajesh Merchandani is in San Francisco. Have you actually seen it, Rajesh?
I've seen it on a TV screen, Jeremy, yes, somewhere over that side of town where it shouldn't have been. It should have crossed this way during the torch relay and then come back down to finish here at Justin Herman Plaza at least an hour ago, maybe slightly less. Hasn't shown up at all. In fact, what we know is that it started uneventfully. The torch was lit from the Olympic flame and the first torchbearer set off with it. But then that torchbearer disappeared into one of the buildings on the waterfront, we think a ferry building, and then a bus was seen coming out of the ferry building, and then it disappeared, and then all of a sudden the torch appeared on the other side of town heading inland. So none of the thousands of people who'd come to see it, more importantly for the Chinese and the Olympic officials, none of the thousands of people who'd come to protest against it had a chance to do that at all. A few shoppers were the ones who got a lucky glimpse.
Given the object of the exercise is to show off the Olympic torch to the people of San Francisco, it hasn't been a towering success then, has it?
Not really. Some of the words I'm hearing around here are shambles and, as you said, farce. Organisers had said that they reserved the right to change the route at the last minute, but I think a lot of people think this is taking it too extreme. They thought they had already announced that they would cut the route in half to just 3 miles instead of the six, and that the torchbearers would pair up. I think there were fears for their security. But then when it actually started, many people thought they would actually do the route that they said it was going to do. Thousands of demonstrators have been here all day. Thousands of pro-China supporters have been here all day. They're right across the road from me over there. They haven't seen it either. So the most talked about Olympic torch relay in history has now become the loneliest.
Well, enjoy yourself, Rajesh. Thank you very much. David Grossman is here in the studio with us. Gordon Brown's, of course, got a bit of a habit of not going to things like the signing of the Lisbon Treaty or whatever. What's the story here?
Well, I can sympathise with Rajesh. I've been rather looking for the flame of truth in whether Gordon Brown was ever going to go to the opening ceremony of the Olympics. What I've nailed down is this. He accepted this invitation from the Chinese in January when he went to China on an official visit. He accepted an invitation to go to the Olympics. It wasn't specified what he would do. Last month, a full 3 weeks ago, his official spokesman said at a briefing for journalists that he would be going to the closing ceremony. Now, it appears unlikely that he ever intended to go to both the opening and the closing. They're 15 days apart. It's a long journey over there. It's a 20-hour return trip. So I think what he's guilty of is using some rather woolly language when a bit of precision would have been necessary.
Why didn't he say so?
Well, that is a very good question. I mean, his Downing Street are emphatic. There was never an intention to go to the opening ceremony. He's not changed
his... But he could have said that.
He could have said that in no uncertain terms, and we would have been saved the bother of trying to unpick this. And more importantly than that, we would have been saved the bother of having it being interpreted around the world that Gordon Brown has snubbed the Chinese. I see that Senator Hillary Clinton, the candidate for the Democratic nomination, has tonight issued a statement commending Gordon Brown for deciding that he was going to pull out of the opening ceremony of the Olympics. No doubt she will be taking some credit, perhaps, for changing his mind.
But he hasn't snubbed them. Well, because he was never going to go.
I think the Foreign Office and Downing Street would point out emphatically that this isn't a snub. He's merely doing what he intended to do all along. Why would he go to the closing ceremony rather than the opening? It's because London has a huge role to play in the closing ceremony. The Mayor of London will receive the Olympic flag, and so, if you like, the torch of the Olympics proceeds to London from Beijing. Britain's big moment is not at the opening ceremony. That's a big moment, of course, for the Chinese and their organisers and national pride for them. But Britain's big moment is at the closing ceremony. And Gordon Brown's people say he always intended to be there.
David, thank you very much indeed.
Now, 11 days after the elections in Zimbabwe, we still don't know what happened. The Electoral Commission there has ordered recounts in five of the parliamentary votes. You'll recall that the result of that election was that President Mugabe's ZANU-PF party lost control. For the rest, it's still clear as mud, which is presumably how Mugabe wants it. Neighbouring states, though, are at last beginning to make noises. Robin Denslow reports.
It's now 11 days since the Zimbabwe elections. There's still no announcement as to who won the presidential contest, which the opposition MDC insist they won. But in their stronghold of Bulawayo, a women's group dared to hold a protest. They threw down their placards outside the High Court and dispersed before they could be arrested.
If the situation wasn't so tragic, it might seem farcical. The opposition have now gone to the High Court to try to get those presidential election results released. There won't be a ruling on that until Monday. If then, for there are worrying reports tonight that those results are now a state secret and that the government is putting pressure on the Electoral Commission.
We understand that the all the members of the Zimbabwe Electoral Commission have been moved to a secret location, and the members of the opposition, the monitors from the opposition, have not been allowed anywhere near where these people have been taken, and the boxes have also been moved. We are now told that the presidential results are now a state secret and they will not be released. We suspect they might now be altering the figures or massaging the figures.
And as Zimbabweans waited and waited to see whether the results would be released, the opposition MDC expressed their concerns that the ballot boxes were being tampered with.
Not only have they moved those ballot boxes, opened those ballot boxes, but they've also stuffed those ballot boxes. In other words, those ballot boxes, they've become pregnant and they've reproduced during the time that we've been waiting since the 29th of March 2008.
What's the problem today?
There were further signs that Mugabe is using every trick he can.
We came here to occupy this place.
War veterans, traditionally used as his shock troops, began taking over some of the few remaining white farms. And at the weekend, state-controlled Zimbabwean television broadcast scare stories as to what the whites were up to.
Reports reaching these organs are that there has been a notable influx of former white farmers moving within their former properties and laying claim to them.
Tonight, their spokesman argued that it seemed that the white farmers had only been allowed to stay in Zimbabwe until now, so they could be used on an occasion like this.
It's a really like a mop-up exercise that's taking place, and it looks really like it was part of the tactic where a few people were kept for sacrificial purposes as and when needed, because whenever there's been a crisis within the political arena, that's when we've been plundered.
For their part, the opposition are trying a very different approach to hit back, regional diplomacy. MDC leader Morgan Tsvangirai has been touring neighbouring states with some success. But tonight, Zambia announced an emergency summit of regional leaders of the Southern African Development Community to discuss the crisis.
Because of the deepening problem in the country, I felt that this matter should be dealt with at the presidential level.
Tsvangirai will try to put pressure on the regional leaders before the meeting. He's already been to South Africa, where the leader of the ANC, Jacob Zuma, today expressed his concern that the election results had not been announced.
I don't think that augurs well with democratic principle. I think once people have cast their votes and have counted, whatever the results are, I think the commission is supposed to announce the results.
Mugabe's justice minister was predictably annoyed.
We are therefore, of course, very disappointed with the posturing that MTC Tsvangirai are doing. In particular, you are aware, of course, the appeal all over, you know, to the UN, to the SADC, African Union, for intervention over an issue which basically does not warrant any intervention.
So what happens next? It looks like a battle between dirty tricks and diplomacy.
Now coming up on the programme, astronomers up in arms at the prospect of the end of blue skies thinking in the country. What is the government up to? Before that, though, a roundup of today's news. Our main story tonight, the International Monetary Fund has said that the world economy will grow much more slowly in the next two years as a result of the credit crunch. The Monetary Policy Committee is under pressure to make another cut in British interest rates tomorrow. Speaking on this programme, the economist Dr. Erwin Stelzer said the MPC should act to stave off recession.
If they overshoot a little bit on cutting interest rates and inflation does take off a bit, which I'm not sure it will, they can reverse gears pretty quickly. But if they guess wrong and keep interest rates too high and don't do the other things that have been suggested, they're going to find themselves in a very, very difficult situation.
The mother of Shannon Matthews appeared in court today to face charges in connection with the 9-year-old's disappearance. Karen Matthews was charged with child neglect. A second charge states she repeatedly concealed information in relation to Shannon's whereabouts. The Matthews house has been boarded up by the council, and the police have warned people not to try to take the law into their own hands. The Islamic preacher Abu Qatada has won an appeal against deportation from the UK, which could lead to him being freed. Qatada, in prison pending deportation to Jordan, has been dubbed Osama bin Laden's right-hand man in Europe. The Home Office says it'll challenge the ruling, and in the meantime, he'll remain in prison. Two high-profile figures involved with Birmingham City Football Club have been questioned by police. The club's managing director, Karen Brady, and co-owner David Sullivan were arrested as part of an investigation into allegations of fraud within the sport. They have since been released on bail. The markets, the FTSE 100 share index was down in New York. The Dow Jones was also down against the euro. The pound was down against the dollar. The pound, though, is up. The knowledge economy, it's our future. It must be so, because the Prime Minister says it is. But 17,500 scientists have written to Gordon Brown to say it's a pity he doesn't put his, or rather our, money where his mouth is. They're angry and distressed at the way the government seems to have decided that pure science, especially physics, is, in the cliché, a poor relation, undeserving of the resources going elsewhere. The consequences haven't been thought through, and they could be dire. Susan Watts reports.
It's one of the most famous telescopes in the world, an icon of astronomical observation. Before it even opened for business, Jodrell Bank's Lovell telescope was front page news for spotting the Soviet missile that launched Sputnik in 1957. It helped discover quasars, the most distant objects in the universe, has found most of the known pulsars, spinning collapsed stars, and even killed off one of the doctors in Doctor Who. This giant radio telescope at Jodrell Bank near Manchester is 50 years old, but it's still at the forefront of international astronomical research. It's become the focal point of extraordinary anger and dismay among scientists, who are in the middle of the biggest funding crisis to hit physics and astronomy for decades. So how did this happen? Years ago, it must have felt as if Jodrell's future could never be in doubt. But last December, within weeks of celebrating the telescope's golden anniversary, astronomers learned that its future and theirs was at risk. The latest science budget overall was up, but with less money for fundamental physics and astronomy. The man who designed this telescope and gave it his name still comes into work 3 days a week, even though he's now 94. How do you feel that such an important part of our astronomical history and our cultural history should be put under threat in this way?
I think it would be a disaster. Quite apart from Jodrell Bank itself, it's not only its national, but its international connections, which are so important. And sacrifice even a part of Jodrell Bank, which I think would be a threat if the present grant is removed, would be very serious indeed.
Hey! Come on!
Younger astronomers devised their own way of dealing with the budget squeeze and promptly put the telescope on eBay. It seemed impossible to believe that the big dish could ever be allowed to shut. In fact, the Astronomer Royal told me he thinks the Lovell telescope itself was never under serious threat, but he is upset about the impact of the serious mismanagement he believes has led to a question mark over its future and that of the whole of astronomy in the UK.
One can't just isolate what may seem rather arcane branches of science and cut them without it having any effect, but one should realise that at a time when we are trying very hard to attract young people into science, these high-profile projects do make a big difference, and it's a real own goal if the UK young people get the perception that to do world-class science in those fields, you've got to go to another country.
Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light-years side to side.
Knocking back any part of science, then, can ripple beyond the relatively small world of astronomy. The worry being that we lose the people and the ideas that will help take us into the future. It's a view that another part of our astronomical heritage shares.
We're living now in the age of science, the scientific world. If we fall back there, we fall back everywhere. And people realise that, I hope the government will. So I don't think there should be any threat, not only to Jodrell Bank, but to the associated programmes. I sincerely hope not.
And our galaxy is only one of millions of billions in this amazing and expanding universe.
So who mismanaged what? The funding crisis has its roots in the merger last year of two of the government quangos that run UK research, both with tediously long names, into one super quango, the Science and Technology Facilities Council, or STFC. Ministers promised there'd be no reduction in funding, but with the comprehensive spending review of December 2007 came news that although science had done well overall, the STFC was in dire straits. One official warned, "Fasten your seatbelts, and when the wagons are circled, remember to shoot outwards." The STFC has so much of its budget tied up in long-term international projects, it faces an £80 million shortfall in cash over the next 3 years. Astronomers have come here to Queen's University in Belfast for their annual meeting, and I want to gauge their mood over the cuts. There's a real buzz at this meeting because this afternoon they get a chance to talk to the man many of them hold responsible. Some blame the government for not giving the new research council enough money in the first place. Others say the council itself hasn't made a strong enough case for basic science. Senior astronomers refuse to accept accusations that they're simply resistant to change.
In astronomy, we're a very vital kind of science. There's always change. There are serious cuts, as a result of which we're having to consider closing projects that are not just things that have been going for decades and have reached the end of their life. These are frontline projects, which in some cases they haven't even started taking data, so they're not even completed yet. And these are the things that are going to be closed. So these are real cuts.
A decade ago, when New Labour came to power, that was the promise. Certainly for this lot, there's been time for the hairstyles to get better. D-Ream's keyboard player, Brian Cox, is now a professor of particle physics at the sharp end of the funding crisis. For him, the cuts undermine the government's own attempts to get more young people into science.
You ask any young person in Britain, do you want to work on research into old people or the Big Bang? And they'll say, the Big Bang. That's a fact of life. It's been borne out in survey after survey. 80% of undergraduates go into physics saying they want to learn about the Big Bang, galaxies and cosmology. Of course, because that's what we all find exciting. We train them and then they go to address the environment and security in an ageing population. I think the government didn't quite realise the damage it would do by making these cuts in fundamental science.
It's not just astronomy that's feeling the pinch. Fundamental physics, like the study of subatomic particles, is being squeezed too. The government plans that the Daresbury Laboratory here at Manchester will become what it calls a science and innovation campus. Others dismiss this as creating little more than a technology theme park. The science minister has come here today to tell scientists they have a bright future. They're going to take a lot of convincing after what's happened over recent weeks. Just like the astronomers, the scientists here say they've been left out of the plans and that the companies coming here have little in common with particle physics. This giant machine called ALICE is at risk. It's a test bed for other particle accelerator projects, one to create targeted cancer therapy, projects which have already cost taxpayers around £25 million.
These are the magnets of one of the extra fees that we have.
Now scientists fear they'll have to switch ALICE off before it can even prove itself. One leading scientist attracted here from the US is already disillusioned enough that he's thinking of going back. But the minister was defiant.
Overall, the budget for the SDFC is up. It's £2 billion over a three-year period.
It amounts to a flat cash, though, doesn't it, over the next 3 years?
Well, I know the STFC would like more money. The other research councils would like more money as well. But we've got world-class science that will continue to be funded by the government as a result of the spending decisions that we took in December.
Back in Belfast, and the astronomers are about to get their first chance to grill the chief executive of the STFC, Keith Mason, and they're angry.
I don't for one minute accept that we should be pleased with the level of funding we had 10 years ago.
I asked Keith Mason how he'd managed to upset so many people so comprehensively.
It's very unusual, isn't it, to have senior astronomers, senior scientists, telling us that they are dismayed and angry about what's happened in the last few months.
And change is difficult, and things can't stay the same always. And, you know, I there's a natural human tendency to regret, turning off machines that are still working. Because you want to invest in something new. But that's what we have to do if we're going to maintain the UK at the world forefront.
People have said to me that you've been arrogant over these decisions, there's been a cavalier approach, and in fact one of the phrases that was used was incredible ineptitude in the management here. Some people think you should resign over it. Are you going to resign?
Absolutely not. I mean, we're talking here about a very difficult job. We have to always make very, very hard decisions. If we're going to keep up in the modern world and to really exploit the bright people we have to succeed in the knowledge economy, that's what we have to do. We have to think in new ways. It'll mean that sometimes people get upset, but it will be worth it if we get to where we are able to do more science and get the impact out of it that it deserves.
Really teaching astronomy really does.
For many here, this confirms their suspicions that what it's all about is pushing funding away from blue skies research like astronomy and fundamental physics.
A couple of years ago, we had an international panel of physicists with Nobel Prize laureates telling us we were world leading. But it's quite a small community, and the problem we're facing is that our national capability is being utterly eroded. So any kind of you may have jam tomorrow, it's all going to be bright and rosy. doesn't really cut the mustard, simply because we're not going to have a national capability in that area anymore.
You mean once it's gone, it's gone?
Once the expertise is gone, it's very hard to recover it, both technical and scientific.
The Astronomer Royal apportions most of the blame for the mess on mismanagement at the STFC.
Certainly, there was poor management and poor planning, and we depend on our high reputation for being efficient in the way we manage, as well as in the quality of our science, and that has been damaged by this ineptitude.
At Jodrell Bank, they still feel under siege. The biggest threat is to something called E-Merlin, an array of radio telescopes, including the Lovell dish, for sensitive radio mapping of the skies.
We knew about the £80 million funding shortfall. We were quite stunned to see that E-Merlin was being considered as one of the facilities under threat. Many of the grants to fund individual researchers have been cut by 25% or more. That's the sort of thing that I think we can live with in the short term. But if the facilities aren't there for the researchers to use, then that is a big problem for the long term.
The choices are always tough. Should we spend on pure or applied science, space probes or manned spaceflight? But squeezing the very subjects that woo the next generation of scientists could prove an own goal. Physics students, fascinated by the stars now, will branch out later to find the technologies that fix climate change or extend healthy lives. Without those students, Gordon Brown's knowledge economy may never happen.
Susan Watts, there's lots more on the story on our website, including an article by Susan and more interviews. Tomorrow morning's front pages. Now, the Daily Telegraph has news that of that story we were covering early, the meeting of the IMF, and the news that we've been very badly hit, more badly hit than many others. According to the Financial Times, though, bankers are saying that they actually messed it up themselves. It's all being seen as an attempt to stave off regulation by them fessing up to having dropped us into this mess. The Independent, the currency crunch, the implications of a more expensive euro, bigger than holidays and the like. Additives, e-numbers and the like do make hyperactive children and delinquent teenagers, according to the Daily Mail. Why we keep on sticking them in our food, I've no idea. Scientists win public support on embryos. That's a poll in the Times. And the news that the Americans apparently helped out the Iraqis in the Battle of Basra, and the Daily Mirror has Shannon Matthews' mother on its front page after her appearance today. That's all from Newsnight tonight. Gavin will be here tomorrow. I know he'd appreciate it if you could make the effort to stay up tomorrow night to join him. It can be terribly lonely otherwise. Good night.
Good evening. Well, today's showers will fade away overnight, leaving clear skies for central and eastern parts. It'll be quite chilly wherever you are first thing in the morning, but we'll also see thicker clouds and some showers working its way into the west. During the day, we'll just push those showers a bit further inland, and as the April sunshine gets to work, some of those showers could well turn out to be quite heavy with a few rumbles of thunder. We've even got some wintry weather to come over the tops of the hills, but I don't think it'll be too significant. And after that bright start east of the Pennines, we'll see a few showers around. The southeast of England could well see one or two light showers, but they're few and far between. Most places fine and dry, good spells of sunshine, a little bit warmer than today, 14 degrees in London. But here are the showers down towards the south and the west of the United Kingdom. Some of the showers here, again, could be on the sharp side, some rumbles of thunder, some hail mixed in, and a good old scattering of showers across Wales. In between the showers, something a little bit brighter, and that's when you'll see those temperatures creeping up into double figures. For Northern Ireland, it'll start bright, but we'll see some afternoon showers, and it'll be quite showery for much of Scotland for much of the day. Showers continue into Friday, and if anything, on Friday the showers could well be that bit heavier, more likely to see some hail and some thunder, and a similar story further south. But again, in between those showers, temperatures should creep up to around about double figures. So Friday itself will be a breezier day, you'll notice that, but also a day of sunshine and showers. Once again, fairly typical April weather with a top temperature of around about 12 degrees. So quite a bit going on in the next couple of days. As ever, keep up to date with it on the website. Good night.
Is everything okay?
Everything's fine.
Anything to do with the boy that he might be looking for?
Don't know what you mean.
Well, he's put himself in a position where he's feeding off his anger and his grief.
Can't do this!
Find out where they're keeping him.
Just when I thought I could not be stopped, when I've broken every door that goes to my life, no wilder than the wind.
Waking the Dead returns. Monday at 9 on BBC One.
When you see somebody performing live, you're hypnotised and you become part of that moment with them. Live music is raw. It's not been tampered with, tampered with. It hasn't been cleaned up, cleaned up afterwards. It's like the joy of the first kiss. It's a magical moment and it's never going to be the same again. It's there and then it's gone, and then it's gone, and it's gone, gone.
No remixing, just raw music. Later is live, with performances from Portishead and The Last Shadow Puppets. Tuesday at 10 on BBC Two.
One of the biggest events in the golf calendar now on BBC Two Wales, with live coverage beginning tomorrow night at 9. Now, what's in store for the US Masters?